Hello, my beautiful people. My name is Dr. Cartel. Welcome to another episode of Basic Nigerian History. Last episode, we spoke about the three different kingdoms, which were Nupe, Junkun, and the Nui people. We finished with the Nui, who had managed to make some expansion into the Benin Kingdom. And I'm sure some of you will be thinking, what is the Benin Kingdom? Well, you're in luck, because this episode, we'll be discussing the Benin Kingdom. Let's get started. The Benin Kingdom, also known as the Edo Empire, has its own creation story legend, which was transmitted orally between generations. The little Edo state was originally called Igodo Migodo, and its rulers were referred to as the Ogisio, which means the kings of the sky. Now, the story goes, Prince Ekaladeha, who was the son of the last Ogisio, had a dispute for power with his uncle. He was then banished and fled for his life. We're not sure why, but we know he had to leave Sha. So anyways, he changed his name to Izodwa, which meant I have chosen a path of prosperity, and traveled to the lands of the Yoruba people, where he eventually became known as Ododua, the ruler of Ife. Yes, the name was corrupted. The Yoruba people changed it from Izodwa to Ododua. Anyways, Oramiyan, who was the grandson or the son of Ododua, I don't really know which one, came back to the land of the Edo people and married a beautiful woman called Erimwinde, who was the daughter of the ninth Inogi. Inogi is like a duke. Basically, I'm butchering the pronunciations, but who do cares? They had a baby, but Oramiyan wasn't completely happy where he was. He declared the land Ile Ibinu, which is Yoruba, that means that it is a land of vexation. He said that only someone born and raised with the mysteries of this land could rule it, and left to go back to Ife, leaving his son as the king. His son's name was Eweka, and there's another long story of how the son got the name. Apparently, he couldn't really speak as a boy, so when he eventually spoke, his first word was Owomika, which in Yoruba means my hand has caught it, but the Edo people corrupted it to Eweka. So I don't know if this is true, but this is just part of the legend. He became Eweka the first Oba of Benin. Oba means king. It was Eweka who changed the name of the state from Igodo Migodo to Edo, and because his lineage went all the way back to the Ogisio, he was considered a direct descendant of God, so he had divine rights to rule. And therefore, all Edo kings after him had divine rights to rule. Now, the Edo kingdom had their own administrative structure. The king was at the top, and the kingdoms were divided up into tribute units, or fiefs. A fief holder was responsible for the daily administration of their respective fiefs. The king was assisted in the government by seven hereditary nobles called Uzama and two other groups of non-hereditary nobles. The empire built impressive long walls, great thoroughfares, and erected 9 fortified gateways. They had lots of impressive walls that must have taken hundreds of years to build, and tales of the great works in the land of Edo spread to the other lands. It also had a powerful and well-disciplined military. The king was the supreme military commander, but he had generals serving under him, and the military were broken down into well-organized units and subunits. I mean, even the queen, the mother of the empire, had her own personal regiment of soldiers. The actions of the empire show that it was led by very clever leaders, and that it was business-oriented. It gained money from 3 main sources: taxes on its waterways, tolls on those who wished to enter the cities to trade, and tributes from the conquered peoples. And trust me, a lot of people wanted to enter the cities to trade after hearing tales of his prosperity and his grandeur and splendor. Craftsmen, artisans, clothes makers, bronze sculptors, carpenters all flocked to the city. The empire soon developed an artistic culture. Bronze, ivory, and iron carving, and all kinds of stuff. This led to some of the most beautiful sculptures that we see today, and also explained why the city was so beautiful and so well designed. From 1440 to 1473, Oba Eruwe, which by the way, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but if I am, they're saying he's the king of goats, meaning he was the goats, you know, the greatest of all time, I think. Or maybe he was just a goat, I don't know. Anyways, Oba Eruwe the Great. It's actually called Oba Eruwe the Great. That's so funny. Let me continue. Oba Eruwe the Great expanded the Edo city into a thriving empire in which Edo was its capital. But the empire came to be known as Ile Ibinu, the Empire of Ile Ibinu, which was the name that Oramiya had already given it. Ebiwe was the first of many great conqueror kings. He introduced the annual Igwe festival and set up a political structure that increased the king's authority and set out to conquer even more lands. Their powerful and disciplined military allowed them to continue conquering neighboring peoples, which they then incorporated into the empire. Soon, the empire contained a large mix of diverse ethnicities, from the Istekeri, the Ison, the Ika, the Ijo, to the Yorubo, and of course the Edo people themselves. The empire gained dominance over Midwestern and Western Nigeria, with its borders being the Oyo Empire to the west and the Niger River to the east. Apparently, due to the large mix of ethnicities and the fact that they spoke different dialects, the original name of the empire was corrupted from Ile Ibinu to Ubinu. Then this was further corrupted to Benin City by the Portuguese when they came in the 1450s. Oh, let's talk briefly about the Europeans now. As you know, the Benin Kingdom is on the coast, so it's only natural that they would be the first ones to encounter foreigners traveling by sea. Now, roughly around 1450, the Portuguese explorers had been lured to Benin by tales of its splendor, and as we know, the people of the kingdom loved to do business and trade. So before we knew it, a trade relationship started. The people of the Benin Kingdom began trading ivory, pepper, and palm oil for guns and manila. Their multiple wars that they had with other people had enabled them to capture a bunch of POWs, prisoners of wars, which became slaves. So at first, the empire was very happy to sell these slaves to the Portuguese in exchange for other items. Even though they sold the slaves in small numbers, it was a decision that they would soon come to regret. And that's it for the Benin Kingdom. We're going to be visiting the Benin Kingdom, also known as the Edo Empire, in the transatlantic slavery era. Come back and find out what happened to that area when, you know, the Europeans probably came and started doing things. As for what we learned that the Edo Empire started off as a state and eventually developed into an empire due to its superior military tactics and discipline. We also learned that they have a connection to the Yoruba peoples in their origin history. And we learned that they became successful by making their waterways and their cities attractive and useful. They taxed people to enter the cities or to use the waterways. The splendor of the city also attracted laborers, artisans, craftsmen, and other skilled workers, which further allowed them to create the impressive sculptures and buildings. The Benin Kingdom understood that if you invest in your nation and make it a place of prosperity, then it's only a matter of time before that attracts more prosperity and everybody else will inevitably want to do business with you. This is something that today's Nigerian leaders seem to have forgotten. Let's hope that sooner or later they remember. Oh, by the way, don't forget to subscribe. Also, you can check us out on Patreon, www.patreon.com/ronucreative. What's on there? You can get access to all kinds of free exclusive videos, products. Basically, you can support us. Okay, just do it. Subscribe. Love you. First, stop recording.